Let's resume our activities for this morning. It is my great pleasure to introduce Professor Li-He Wang from the University of Iowa. He will continue his third lecture on the basic regularity theory for elliptic PDEs. And today he will discuss the Hilda regularity for solutions of linear equations in divergence form following the DeGeorge Nash Moser approach. So Li-He, with no further ado, thank you.
Okay, so I will try to reproduce the proof of Hilda regularity when the equations really becomes random in certain sense. And actually, yesterday, Louis explained that it's a very, very important to think the equation's coefficient is only bounded measurable for nonlinear equations. So that part I will skip. So the equation we are thinking today is this one. And we assume Aij is satisfy these conditions. Actually, I better write this way. It's a little bit different. And Aij also bounded, say. It's maybe different constant. So this way, actually, I kind of secretly avoid the assumption like Aij is symmetric. If I write the other way, Aij has to be symmetric. This is the only condition. I mean, these two, actually. So, and it's very easy use the method what we proved before, what we used yesterday, to prove this equation has a solution. It's you just form this a kind of bilinear form. And if Aij is a symmetric, everything is perfect. This is a Hilbert space norm, and under the condition that if U's boundary is zero, and then you use Ries representation theorem to prove there's a solution with reasonable right-hand side, exactly line by line. Then in the case Aij are not symmetric, then Locke and the Milgram approval theorem is basically up to a rotation here. It will be symmetric. And you can solve this equation anyway. So the mathematics is pretty easy, but that actually hides the issue a lot. How it was hided is that what Aij means, right? And what's going on? Let me put a very easy question that, can you give me an example of the solution? It's very difficult, you know? It's other than like you threw in constant to the equation, that solved the equation. It's really hard to write down any other explicit solution. There's no way to do it. A special situation would be that one dimension. I mean, actually, Louis did this example. This means that equals a constant, so u prime equals c over a of x. And the u would be integration of that. So you can see that the derivative really is like a duality. The derivative jumps inverse proportional to how a jumps. And use this condition that a is just between two numbers, right? That still doesn't really explain what AIJ means. So let's see one example, say 4, say uxx plus uyy, right? I mean, just make this so easy like this 4. Then I explained a lot about when this 4 was, well, 1, things was perfect. It's the equation is symmetric. Every point is exactly the same as any other point. But if you put a 4 there, right, what's the intuition? Then you better think about like that, because this constant, you can switch it anywhere you want. It's like, right? If this is a variable, you cannot do this. That's a change of variable are not allowed, but 4 would be easy. So what this means is that if you look at this equation, instead of looking the variable x, y, if you are looking at the variable of x over 2, y, it's just Laplacian. So and the Laplacian, you might think about like information propagation, which is very much indicated by this function. Whatever happened at the origin is propagates in all directions. At each other x, the universe fills the reaction here exactly that amount. It's 1 over x to the n minus 2. Then use this change of variable, I can say exactly the same thing. So what's going on is that when this was 1, this was 1, like one decimal away, more or less, x like 2 decimals away. So in the x direction, the information propagates faster, right? Exactly twice as faster. So this coefficient indicates how the information propagates in different directions. And the condition, let me just think about AIJ is positive, definitely symmetric. So what that really means is at each point, that positive matrix defines preferred directions of information. And the preferred direction is bounded by this 2. Let me put it another way. So if you look at this table, right? There are some fibers. Then the heat will propagate a little bit faster in the fiber direction than the other directions, right? I mean, there is a constant. That's exactly what AIJ means. Then what is coefficient? This, you better think about at each point, there is a change of coordinates. Depends on that point. That can be changed to Laplacian. Then at each point, the preferred direction of heat propagation, or weighted, they are different. A practical situation is that in the future, you know, you look at my clothes, they are fiber directions. In the fiber direction, AIJ is a little bit bigger. In the future, the clothes won't be knitted. It will be random materials. All the materials created before and created in the future, you put them together. Then you study the heat propagation on those kind of materials. That is the equation reflected or described by this PDE. It's a random material with bounded preference altogether. Okay? And so it's complicated. Is AIJ really random? In all the statements of theorem, they say whatever the theorem is, it's independent AIJ. You are not allowed to think about what AIJ is. You better think about AIJ. Really, really random coefficients. That's also reflected here as it's in two dimensions and above. It's impossible. It's almost, I don't know how do you write down a very easy, explicit solution. So, and from here, you can more or less expect that the best theorem, best possible, is U is Lipschitz, right? So gradient U is is bounded. So this really in the spirit of Schelder theory. Schelder theory basically says that those two, you try to prove these two have the same regularity. We know that's impossible. So what the George and the Nash proved is that actually the solution is Hölder continuous, which is equivalent to say that you mix up the materials. No matter how do you mix it, you never can make a temperature jump. So temperature always continuous. So what they prove that you is always Hölder continuous. But before I do that, let me show you that. Maybe later on I will do it. It's actually, this is equivalent to U is continuous. If you prove a theorem for a scaling invariant class, which we do, prove a theorem about the continuity of that class, then the continuity always implies is Hölder continuous. So Hölder continuous is like the trademark of this kind of problems. So that's basically the question. You try to prove you never make the jump. So what continuity really means is more or less is the solution we observed, which is a constant, is a stable. Right? You can only observe one. So you show that's a stable. And which is equivalent to say that U of X and U of Y, they like each other. Right? You see, they negotiate. Nobody is really wild. Nobody is more important than the other one. So let me start with a lemma, which is we did it before, the energy estimate, and I did the localized gradient estimate. This is even easier. So let me assume. Say write it down. So it's a minus sign doesn't really matter. V squared gradient U squared. This was C. For any V is C theory. And if you think about it, that's almost the only thing you can do. So you use the definition. You multiply, because I don't assume U is zero there. It's hard to do anything. So you cut it off, and you integrate. So by definition, that equals to zero, right? Then you do the expansion. I mean, this you better think this multiply this integrate, but. Logically, you say, by the definition, weak solution, this is true. It's really thinking and what you are right, they're a little bit different. So now you expand that. Right? This. There are two terms. Then add 2 phi I, aij, uj. Then again, this is quadratic in the gradient. This is linear in the gradient. So you can make that linear term disappear. You group this together. So and this would be you use the definition lambda gradient b squared gradient u squared, right? This really the definition. Then this don't have a sign, so you just give up. Then you put a epsilon, so you get epsilon gradient phi squared gradient u squared plus 1 over epsilon. Maybe there's a lambda gradient phi squared, u squared. So you take epsilon, say, lambda over 2. So that's a check. That's a proof. So what you observe is that you have a local gradient estimate. And you have a lot of corollaries. So this phi, for example, you don't really have to take C0 infinity. It's this leap, 0 will be fine. So if you take the phi something like that, like the tan function, it works. Or right. So then this phi in half ball have a lower bound. So you get gradient u squared half ball. This all equals once that is explicit, you know, this slope is say 1. I mean this will be half. So you get C u squared ball. So this is the thing you have to stare at it over and over again. Actually, the method is to use that over and over again. And the first observation is that since we have an inequality, right? Inequality at the end, we don't need identity here. So if this list all equals 0, we'll be fine. And this is, again, of course, you call it subsolution. And this is, we call that local energy estimate. And the local energy estimate, as I did before, means a scaling invariant version. So the correct way of writing it is actually this. The average of gradient u squared. Well, this I can wait it. Really doesn't matter. It's a if you want you can right. This is the scaling invariant version. So this is equivalent to say. Exactly same constant. F L U is I missed the sign. It's minus this all equals zero. Everything is a scaling invariant. They are mathematically equivalent. Okay now. So what's that mean? Actually you win already. So this, as I said, is that this by use Sobolev embedding, this has a restricted decay than L2 function, and you say this at all points in all scales. So this is like a self-correcting. This basically means that U's value does not like infinity. Right? Exactly means that. Because L2 basically says that the chances for the value to take near infinity is 1 over lambda squared.
That should be non-negative, right?
What's non-negative? Oh, no, it depends on which L I call. So if I call this minus L, it's, right.
But the solution is sub-solution.
Oh, no, I never use a non-negative. Yeah, right. So you have that. So now, to put things more explicitly, we can do this. And the Soviet embedding of this does not really hold with non-zero, but we can do something like this. Let me forget that annoying quarter first. I add that. This is not very important, right? I can add maybe the C0 plus 1. Then the Soviet embedding is really true, because otherwise I cannot. And that this is equivalent to, say, the averages about half u 2n over n minus 2. 2n or minus 2. Less or equal. Now, this constant I want to keep. And this is, you just rearrange the constant, you observe this. And this is really means that. Any point u does not like infinity. And as Diego told me that actually you can more or less simplify this problem like 50% to your advantage. So what you observed is an equation like that. And the only thing right now we can say the solution, this is in L2. And this is you have possible, you have spikes, and the gradient might have spikes here and there. That's basically your enemy. And the first step to make the problem like 50% to your advantage is you first cut this by zero. You look at that. Why you want to look at that, because the value of u already 50% concentrated. U plus is a subsolution. And the u minus is also a subsolution. It's very easy to show. So now we are basically facing this kind of situations. Then what this mean really means that what I said yesterday, the distribution function decays morally like 1 over lambda. It's almost exact intuition. Then this, in this tiny little ball, in smaller ball, it decays like a little bit. Is 2n over n minus 2. Is you put the absolute value if you want. But you lose by a constant. Okay? So, but nevertheless, you win. Now, whenever you observe this, and this is true in all scales, and for all the solutions, what do you do? You iterate. And this is, again, let me write down another scaling invariant version. We just wrote it down. Is that LU, it's which one I want to use, LU, minus, less or equals to zero. You say, let me keep this, then I have u 2n over n minus 2 ball r over 2. Same constant. This is right, this is like, I have that. Now, I want iterate this. Of course, I want to make this as L2 integral. Then I look at this function. But the danger is if you want to iterate this, every time you multiply this constant, right? You have C1 square, you go nowhere. But there's a tiny little detail. So observe that. This U, in the case, this is where I better play with positive sub-solution, is that this, in that parenthesis, this is a sub-solution. Actually, U to A, any power bigger than 1 is a sub-solution. It's very easy to check. Now you can use this. Of course, you want to use this in half ball. It's before you do the computation, you say, oh, this is impossible to reach anywhere. Let's write it down. You have ball a quarter, right? Because right hand side, you better u half. Then u n over, right? This function is a sub-solution. I use this of this line. But u is replaced by that, and r is replaced by half, right? And exactly same constant. That has to be emphasized. So this thing squared, half, bigger or equals to c1, u would be n over n minus 2 to the power n over 2n over n minus 2. Outside is 2n over n minus 2. Crystal clear, right? And if you do it one more step, C1 seems deteriorating. But there's a little tiny detail. Is this not in the iterative form yet? You see? I have to raise, because this is not to the homogeneity one power. I have to raise it. Raise that way, right? So I have to do that. Then I have to do that. Then look at that power, less than 1. That's a tiny window of opportunity. Wins the game. So let's, you see that? Then, you keep computing, right? This is capped. Is a C1, n minus, then this, by that line, is C1 again, ball 1, u squared, half. So this one power, this is a fractional of 1. The next line will be easy. You keep doing this, and everybody can do it. You get ball 1 to the k, u, n over n minus 2 to the k 2, 2 other way around, n minus 2 k, less or equals to c1 to the n to every time you have to take like inverse of that power. Nobody can stop you doing this over and over again. Then what do you got? This actually goes to u 0 if 0 is a Lebesgue point. If you don't believe me, at least that is true. If you still don't believe me, because this is like higher power averages. It's less bigger equals to his arithmetic average, because that's higher powers. And now you believe me. if U is the big point at the origin, of course, this number will go to U0. And you can do it at every point in the half-ball. So since almost every point of a function of L2 is the big point, right? So I prove the first step of this, and which is giant step. It's like this, I 100% guaranteed you that you really does not like infinity. Just so let me draw the picture again. You better stay at ball 2. Then you draw ball 1. Then at each point, you start here with ball 1. You half ball, you reach the integrability. Then quarter ball, you reach a better integrability. You do it infinite many times. Then at that point, I estimate that U of x is less or equals to all the way back to, actually I can compute it, C1 plus n over n minus 2 over n plus da da da. So this C1 is one over reverse that, right? That's explicit. Because this is a subset of that. You can write that way if you want. And this is the local area infinity estimate. So this is a giant step. Any weak solution. Is locally bounded. And also with estimate. Although this I have to 2 to 2.5, but I already say that the shrinking doesn't matter. You know, you can easily arrange to half ball. So let me write it this way. Maybe C3 use everything. Right? You can do that easily. So now. So what's the meaning of this? It's already like, if you use L2 norm, say it's 1. What's that mean? U's distribution can be already random distributed. But the major chunk of the value will be finite, right? It's like, and the conclusion that you can draw a bar is high enough. That there is no chance for the solution to go up. So U has. So the first step, I cut the possibility of U 50%. U cannot be almost artificial, cannot be negative. Now I draw a line. U cannot go up. Right. And which is really amazingly strong is we killed in certain sense like 99% of the quantum effect. U can still be random here, but no chance to go up. Okay, so then what do you do next? So normalization. Once U is bounded, you assume U is like that in ball one, right? You do that. So you see this is your picture. This is 0, 1, negative 1, kind of ball one. Then U is something like that. Still, not continuity yet, but you see U's value really concentrated. Now, you are facing the problem that you need a reason to move on. This solution might be constant 1 or constant 0. Then which direction is your effort? Right? You cannot say, I want to push the solution in the one direction. The solution might be 0. Right? You need the light at the end of the tunnel, the direction you put your effort into. Then it's kind of a voting method. It's like, you first say cut it by half. The cutting can be any way you want. You cut it, then they are either 50% of the value go up or go down. Or it depends on which way you want to cut. It doesn't matter. You look a point of view, you do a pull. It could be in half a ball. It doesn't matter. If there's a reason, for example, there's a 50% of the point is bigger than equals to half of that. So try to show. U is bigger or equals to epsilon 0, right? If this other way around, you do the other way around. And this is not a condition. This condition comes to you always free. Because you just turn the picture upside down. If this is wrong, then you turn the picture upside down, it will be true. Or you're just working on 1 minus U, or you wanted to push it up. This is a free condition, but it is very convenient and important. Okay, then what do you want to do now? Is the following. You do a panelization. So suppose you are in this situation. You more or less look at here. That is a super solution, right? And there are lots of things get stuck to this half. And you can also raise this level into 1. It doesn't matter. And we have this amazingly powerful estimate. It basically says that you already win because you cut the infinity. The infinity compared with the finite range is basically 99.9%. You are 99.9% win. U does not like infinity. The value is the majority wins. And you have clear line to cut it. Then how do you do this? Is that, of course, you make a change of variable. You kick the value here to infinity, and you do it. If you do that, then you more or less done. So how do you make this 0 to infinity? Right? There are a couple different ways. Like one over U, right? We'll do the job. The best way is actually log of U. The log of U is mathematical limit of U to the epsilon. Actually, It's really the zero power. It's the homogeneity zero power function. And then let's do that. So log, I want to put this half into like zero. So of course, I compute 2u, right? 2 makes half 1. Then is negative part, right? It's make the solution positive. And this is this guy's picture. Half and zero here. This is u, this is log. It's a convex and decreasing, everything is really nice. And this is a subsolution. And with a lot of zeros, right? Whenever u is bigger equals half, then 2u bigger equals 1, then negative qubit. So now I use my favorite estimate, right? Log of 2u negative part sub for half is less or equals to c log of 2u negative part for 1. And this function has a lot of zeros. Then I have to think about how do I estimate this term. And if I can do that, I'm done. So how do you do that? And two ingredients. One is a boundary type lemma, is that if u equals to zero, say in ball one, is half of the measure. The half doesn't really matter. Then the Poincaré inequality is true. There are a whole class of Poincaré type inequalities. The test of Poincaré inequality is that you just let the right hand side equals to zero, whether the condition is good enough to imply u equals to zero. For example, if this equals to zero, then u has to be constant. But if u is constant with those kind of conditions, the constant has to be zero, so there's a true inequality. Then that's true. So I won't prove it. Actually, it's like you change any constant, it would be. Second one, let me write it here. So log of u has a miracle estimate for the solutions. You can see throughout the years, we look at the proof. Right now, the proof is so easy. I assume u is bigger or equals to zero. So then you can do the following. You model the equation by 1 over u and do that. It's a little bit illegal when u equals to 0, but never mind. You take limit. As a dual approximation, then it is fine. So then you just close your eyes, do the computation. You let me put a minus sign. So this equals to, when you take derivative in here, it's phi squared uj u squared aij u. This is i. This is i. then minus phi 2 aij uj. This is still zero. So you see a positive term, which is quadratic in ui over u. This is linear in uj over u. So you can kill the linear term. So you get lambda phi squared, and this is gradient u over u. But gradient u over u is log of u. Gradient log u squared. These are equals to, of course, you play the same trick. You group them together and pay a little bit. And we start with the tricks we did over and over again. We get C1 gradient phi squared. This one. Right? It's like you group this, you group that, it take epsilon like a properly chosen. So the linear term disappears. Then this is amazing. This is, you shouldn't believe this, but this inequality is in front of you. It's right hand side, there's no u. You get a like naked estimate of a log of u. How could that be true? The reason is log of u is homogeneity zero. When the left-hand side is homogeneity zero, the right-hand side should be homogeneity zero too. So you cannot put anything there. So this means this guy is bounded uniformly. And of course, that estimate is also work on 2u, right? So now I get C1. I mean, I can throw away the minus sign. It's about 2 gradient phi squared. Actually half, but anyway, this is the end. So we did the job. Let me write it down. And so this is a free condition. And so what we proved is that, is actually I have to play with ball too, but it's like shuffling this size of ball and squeezing is f u is less or equals 1, bigger or equals to 0. And this condition is maybe half. And let me just, there's a free condition, free symmetric condition. Then I have log of negative part is bounded. This is, of course, the same thing as u is bigger or equals to epsilon 0 for x in half form. But if you shrink a little bit, and then this same thing I say, u is a bigger or equals to epsilon 0 in quadruple. But if this symmetric condition is not true, this condition negative, then we get 1 over u is bigger or equals to epsilon 0 in 4. Right? If not true, you turn the picture upside down. You get 1 minus u. Then these two conclusions, you can actually put them together. And I think I think the George did it. The best way of writing this, either this or that, you say oscillation of u in ball quarter, less or equals to 1 minus epsilon 0. Now, this statement, you can put it in a scaling invariant way. And then this is scaling invariant way is you first, this means the oscillation equals 1. So it means that scaling invariant way is F LU equals 0 in ball 1. Then the oscillation of U in ball a quarter less or equals 1 minus epsilon 0 oscillation of U in ball 1. Then again, you can write this in further scaling invariant way. You can R over 4, less or equal exactly same constant. Then of course, it's exactly the picture I have to draw many times. It's like we start out with this 0 to 1. Then the conclusion is this is in quarter ball, you lose the freedom, sometimes both, but at least one side. This is 1 minus epsilon 0, and before was 1. You find the range, you cannot go there. So use value has concentration. But if use value has concentration with respect to scale, you can do it over and over again. Then in 116 balls, you push it even further. You do it over and over again, then what's this? Zigzag things. Actually, you can draw a lily flower both above and below. Okay, so let me do the computation. And this, actually, once you reach here, you are done. And you should observe this lily flower thing. So now. You iterate that statement at the very end, you get oscillation ball half to the k u. It's less or equal to 1 0 oscillation u say k minus 1. And you do it k times, you get or k minus 1 times. Now you better think, what is the variable? This is your x. Okay. Then this is x to a power. This minus 1, really artificial. This plus a number, you lose a number, is insignificant. Then you can write this as the variable's power. Any two powers you can relate it. So a way to do it, you better look at that picture, or just do this computation. It's e log of 1 minus e. 0. Then you say I want change that to half, to a quarter. And the k raise it to here. So it equals to, then you land it back here. Hey. And this. You define this by alpha. As it's a very tiny little constant. This is a negative number. That's also a negative number. Epsilon is very, very tiny. So I mean, every mathematician is sort of proud of this. Is that lambda can be like 10. If you throw out all the computations, this like millions, very, very tiny number. But through the iteration, we capture that. And because this epsilon is very small, it's very tiny. This is one tiny and a negative. So the ratio. So you see that U of X minus U of say zero. That's the you put X in this ball or in this ring. In all these rings, the X and this radius, they are the same, mutually comparable. So then the oscillation, of course, including this number minus that number, just this whole thing. But the X is this number now. Now this list all equals to the interchange of X to here. There's a constant, like a quarter. And a constant like here. So 4, 1 minus epsilon 0 x to the alpha. And that's it. Let's hold the continuity. So what we did really, we captured the little window of opportunity is that we see this L2 function controls the LP power. The P is bigger than 2. Just use that window of opportunity, but we use that estimate at every point, every scale. Then we gradually push the value, talk to each other. And the philosophically, like use value at the origin, U of zero, depends very much nonlinearly on Aij. It's jumping like crazy. If Aij change a little bit, U zero will dance with it. But we kind of capture it. In each scale, we do a certain detection. It's either push it up or push it down. But at the very end, we capture this U zero 100% accurately. And if you capture that, it already means that it's holder continuous. Okay, so let me convince you that continuity means holder continuity. So suppose, say, I give you a problem like this. This is have this property that equals to zero. This means a scaling invariant class. Right? It's you scale it, you multiply by constant, satisfies same equation. Then suppose somebody tell you that, oh, I prove a different marginal continuity, the marginal continuity words will say C over say log of R. Right? I mean this words, right? Suppose somebody claim he can do that. Then I want to prove for you, if he can prove this, he already proved holder continuity. It's pretty easy to do. Because this is also translation invariant. Right? This continuity means it's legal to write U zero. So you write U zero there, and you know it doesn't matter. You do a translation. So now you can take X, this thing will goes to zero as this goes to zero, right? This If you have a theorem, the theorem independent of u is in this class. So eventually, it will be less or equal to half u minus u. Right? Because that goes there. Eventually, that will be true. So this you can take soup. Then what's in front of you? You proved the oscillation from ball 1 to ball r0. The oscillation shrink by half. Then you forget whatever he said. From 1 to r0 is half. From R0 to R0 squared will be a quarter. Then you iterate that. Again, you see the oscillation decays like a power of the distance. What is that? It's Hodder continuity. So there's no way to prove a theorem of the scaling invariant class other than Hodder continuity. And the Hodder space is particularly friendly for elliptic equations. Because we proved, the Schelder theory says, it is isomorphism in a reasonable setting. So everything fits. So this is really a fundamental theory for the elliptic equations. So let me use my rest of my time to put some remarks. Basically is a generalization of other equations. So the remark said, let me first say Schelder. The proof, if you look at proof, there's a smallness condition and normalization. Right? You normalize into one, makes the mind a little bit clearer. But there's a smallness. And this really, for linear equations, the smallness is not a condition. But for nonlinear equations, for example, if you look at harmonic map, it's like J, UJ, gradient U squared. This is harmonic map of the U into this. Omega Rn into this. It's like. Then you can run the same argument with some. Sometimes the argument is harder, but the thing you can prove expected would be this. Then the thing shrinks. Right? And this is true. Energy minimizer. Slot like a stationary. Etc. Then this smallness cannot be removed. You cannot, if you change the equation as we did for the linear equation, that's illegal. But nevertheless, you say, well, if this is a theorem, you can put this theorem in a scaling invariant way. So R, 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 R. Right? This is R squared. You scale everything with U. Don't change U. Then guess what? Then you look at all the points such that this is actually look at that set. If less than eta would be good, right? So it's bigger than eta. You call that a singular set. And this is a familiar. That's this thing goes to gradient U of X almost every R. But you have R square in front of it. So you have a lot of chances to make this thing does not happen. The other thing happens. So this is really rare occasion. As a matter of fact, if you take upper limit is not goes to zero. This should be defined as the singular set. And this is the same proof of the Lebesgue point theorem. You can prove the Hausdorff dimension of the singular set. N minus two dimension is actually zero. And that is the partial regularity theorem. And I can also write this into like a minimum surface theory. Then for minimum surface, you don't have this because you start out the assumption that the solution is very close to a hyperplane. And that don't have this R squared in front of it. So for nonlinear equation, that will be it. And the other remarks I want to say is lower order terms. For example, I only did Laplacian, right? What happened? If you put this generality, it would be something like that. Actually, it's easy to do. So if you close the eye, say one example is this local energy estimate. For example, you close the eye, do this computation. You times a test function. Then, of course, you put the phi here, right? Then you get phi gradient U squared. This two is forced. You cannot do anything. Then this phi U term is sublevel embedding term. It's the thing. The sublevel embedding allow you to write, you can legally write it. So let me do this. You see half plus that number. And the exponents will be added into one. Right, this. So this half. So what left is a 2/2n. So inside should be bn. So then what do you say? You say that if bn, say ball one, is sufficiently small, everything okay. Right? If you do the computation on the C term, you see n over 2. Everything will be OK under this condition. Then let me see. And of course, people knew this long time ago. And this condition actually also scaling invariant. If you do this Rx, if you do this computation, you will see this. This is used sub R plus. Then this thing error and norm. Is exactly equals to B x and is error and norm invariant. But there's a slight window of opportunity, which is if B is in error n, this automatically small, but smallness depends on the function B itself. It's not a priori, depends on the norm. But if this power is a little bit bigger than n, this speed depends on that norm number only. This depends on the function, right? But nevertheless, if B is in error n, depends on the integrability of the B, you can always do this, so that term is irrelevant. And all the computation holds, and you get the computation. You have to, the C term, you have to be careful, because C is, when you do, it depends on what kind of estimate you want to do. If you want like a holder estimate, you, from time to time, you have to move constant. If you move constant, the C sometimes move to the right-hand side. So the condition on C and F would be the same. And why this is happening? Another remark is, do you remember I say that this should hold the continuous always something like that? Then Ln is what's Ln's holder continuity? The minus n over n is negative one. So this, when this guy is negative one, this is second order equation. This is u divided by distance. When this is negative one, this is exactly the order of singularity of the equation. So you are not expected to have a regularity because they are the same. However, when this condition is given by integral, you have this little window of opportunity to say this actually in the same order but tiny. Then you have the regularity. But if this term you change to 1 over x, would be a difficult problem. It depends on the very precise behavior. A similar can be said that this Ln over 2 is minus 2 modulus this holder continuity. Then I have a few seconds. Then put another remark is the dynamical problem. So you have this u this is still open. Whether you can prove this solution always smooth. Then what is the current knowledge of this? Is this guy is in L5, which implies regular. But why 5 in this setting? Is this is the three dimension plus time. Time for parabolic equation usually count like two. So this is a five dimensional space. So this is the intrinsic dimension. So when u equals L5, this u's intrinsic regularity is that's 1 over r. It's the same as Laplacian, same as u to the t. And that's the only thing as a current state of technology and those kind of scaling invariant conditions, plus a little bit of smallness. For L5 is free. You have a regularity, and nobody went beyond that. So I'm talking about everybody. You're welcome to think about this question that's still open. So good luck, and thank you very much.